So this session will be chaired by Professor Gautam Kulkarni. So I now hereby give the mic to Professor Kulkarni to chair the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this session. And our first talk is by Dr. K. Lakshmi Narayanan, who is, as you see from his biography on page 55 in the book, he's a very, very experienced automotive engineer and researcher. He has authored more than 50 research papers, and he's a fellow of the SAE and a fellow of the Indian National Academy of Engineering. And he's written two books on modeling of diesel combustion, and on his next book will be Critical Component Repair of Parts in Heavy Duty Engines. And we really look forward to listening to his talk on compact engines for off-road applications. One more thing as we start, please try to keep to the time. It's a long day, and everyone wants to get away, I suppose. But
thank you, Professor. Today I'm going to talk about the compact engines. The new family of engines developed in our company for off-road applications. The entire project was conceived about 6 years back, and it was supervised by our chief engineer, Mr. P.K. Sethi Kumar, whose name I have written at the top, and I have been a catalyst to move the projects. I'll be talking about two engines. One is two-cylinder, and the other is the single-cylinder, and how we multiply each as a big family and then proliferate it in various industrial applications, especially off-road. So, if you see the report of the Ministry of Science, we have 85% of households cultivating about 36% of the cultivable land in India. Thus, the average land holding of the small Indian farmer normally does not exceed 4 acres. So, it is proposed that in the near future, with more subdivision of the land, the usual standard 35 horsepower tractor in India will be very high powered, and there will be a requirement of low powered tractors which are optimal for the land holdings. So the driver for the development of the engines naturally is the emission standards, and we are fortunate to have slightly easier emission standards to achieve when we are talking about power less than 19 kilowatt. However, we want to assure life of 8,000 hours beaten life, and fuel consumption and smoke as good or better than the high powered engines for the same acreage. So we targeted for EPA Tier 4 final, and how to upgrade this to stage European stage 5. Already these tractors are exported to advanced countries. So these standards are expected to be valid in India till 2026, and the stage 5 will be developed in 2026. So first we will talk about the two-cylinder engine, the Simpson's compact engines named SC engines, and 2 and 3 means two-cylinder 1.3 liter. The first engine that was launched was naturally aspirated. We had constant speed engine and also variable speed engine. Constant speed engine is mainly for power generation. This generates 11 kVA at overload conditions and passes stringent Indian emission norms. And we have variable speed engine for tractor and industrial applications greater than 22 and 25 horsepower. Then we will take up the temperature engine. So first we developed the combustion system. We went for open combustion system for fuel economy, and then we used the popular inline fuel injection pump with a mechanical governor that can be easily serviced in India anywhere. And then inland in exhaust cams were designed slightly asymmetric to have good flow. The swirl and flow graphs as desired for matching the combustion system is shown on the right side. We also designed the cams, inlet exhaust cams, optimized by shifting, creating a small asymmetry for enhanced volumetric efficiency. You can see the volumetric efficiency improvement after the asymmetry is done or after optimization is carried out. We developed crankshaft. You will see this engine has got two pistons which move exactly in 360 degrees phase. That means to the eye they move in phase. The advantage is you have uniform power production, unlike in other popular two-cylinder engines where the firing order is not uniform. You have 0, 240, then 720, whereas here we have 0, 360. In this case, because the firing is so uniform, you need a flywheel which is less than 22 kg. Otherwise, you would have needed around 50 kg to have a good control over the engine speed. Also, this engine has got a primary force balancer. We have balanced all the reciprocating forces to an extent of 97%. This balancer is made of steel and it rotates in the opposite direction. For low speed applications, namely for 1500 rpm genset, we have SJM balancer shaft for cost reasons. However, the balancing is only 60%. It doesn't matter for low speed. So we have the flywheel crankshaft design which is very compact, and pistons move in phase just as I said now, unlike in other conventional two-cylinder engine. But it has got other difficulties. The pressure inside the crankcase is highly fluctuating. This has to be rectified just like in other single-cylinder engines by providing a valve. So you can see the performance, torque variation and specific fuel consumption of the two ratings, 22 and 25 horsepower engine. They are the state-of-the-art fuel consumption with a very high backup torque. That means lugging is really graceful when used these engines in the machines. And the smoke is completely absent to the unaided eye. Also, as I said in the start, that emission is important. You can see the emission standards are given below brown and deep blue. And what was achieved with the substantial margin is shown at the top. So similarly, carbon monoxide NOx with degradation factor for 25 horsepower engine was achieved, and these engines are certified and the performance is monitored by the authorities every year. So these are some of the tractors in which this 22 and 25 horsepower engine is used. You can see they are styled to the latest norms, and this is how they are working in the field. We have also marine application. We have boats running with these two-cylinder engines which are very quiet and well balanced. We have these engines are suitable for 1500 rpm and 3000 rpm power generation. We made some models in the R&D, validated the design, and we designed the canopy. The noise limit is 75 dB A scale, and we achieved less than 73 dB. So these are some of the models. And we have ratings at 7 kVA, 10 kVA, and manual control, automatic main failure, remote control, and also they satisfy CPCB2 emission norms as well as the noise limits. You can see a remote operation of the engine with a mobile phone. You can send an SMS or use a small app to start the engine over a long distance, maybe 1,000 or 2,000 kilometers. And the engine starts, and by Wi-Fi you can connect it to the computer, or you can see the performance on your mobile. And the internal controls inside the genset will override your control from remote. That means in case of emergency, the genset will take its own decision and switch off. That is the decision it will make. Otherwise, you don't have no need for genset, and start or stop the engine. You will know the fuel level, oil level, everything by sitting in one place at a far distance. That means you can be an owner of say 10 gensets, one in Delhi, one in Bangalore, one in Chennai maybe, and many other Guwahati, and you can just check the performance everything from a distance. Now we have to switch it off. So then we have done the turbocharging and intercooling of this engine. This you would have found very rarely. People are afraid to turbocharge a two-cylinder engine because the firing of a conventional two-cylinder engine is non-uniform, and you can easily make the turbocharger surge. But because the firing is very uniform here, this engine is amenable to turbocharging. In fact, I'd like to say here, this is the first turbocharged aftercooled two-cylinder diesel engine that has been commercialized for the first time in the world. Okay, so the credit goes to my group of engineers. So we have a variable speed 35 horsepower, 2500 rpm. This is going for tractors and industrial applications. And constant speed rated at 23 horsepower at 1500, that is for regular power generation, 23 at 1800, where there is a 60 hertz requirement. Also, in India, we sell this for welding genset applications. We have a 25.4 1500. This is actually a 20 kVA. So these engines are sold everywhere in the world because CPCB2 emission standards are tighter than current European and American emission standards. And also it will satisfy the emission standards of those advanced countries in the foreseeable future. We made, to make this turbocharged engine, we made a model. On the right side you see this is the model for the engine. You can say a paper pencil model. We can predict the performance of the turbocharger by having the right side graph and the map of the turbine and the compressor connected by the shaft. So this is a regular thermodynamics work. This engine can go up to an altitude of 2000 meters without any gear. Normally, turbocharged engines are developed so that there is no derating up to only 1500 meters, whereas we have done this up to 2000 meters. Very rarely you will find applications where above 2000 meters altitude. So this engine suffers no derating almost anywhere in the world. And we have made the air filter suitably sized for minimum life, minimum loss of pressure and maximum life of the engine. So this is how the high altitude derating is calculated from first principles. And we provide this graph. You can see here up to 2000 meters, even at 60 degrees centigrade ambient, you won't have derating, but you don't expect 60 degrees ambient at 2000 meters. But when we went for turbocharging, we had to strengthen the crankshaft. So what we did the fillet hardening, and we tested a number of samples at a high frequency fatigue rig. You can see the fatigue strain has increased by about 100 MPa from 400 MPa, and this satisfies our pressure requirement when the engine is turbocharged and intercooled. So we measured the cylinder pressure and later checked the strength of the engine by running it and a variable load, variable speed, a constant speed, overload for 1000 hours. So we validated all the performance of the engine. And we rigged up the engine for measuring the inside parameters like pressure and steady state data. Everything, this is how it looked when the engine was conceived at the test bed, and the performance is given here. You can see it has got a backup torque of 25%. Again, this turbocharged engine is having a very good torque backup so that it can lift gracefully when it is getting an industrial, when it is applied to cranes and earth movers and other applications. And this is the smallest turbocharger with a wastegate in the world. This wastegate is made so that it is used to have a wide speed range of application. That means 800 to 2500 RPM. Again, this satisfies emission norms, not here for final, but here for interim, okay, and this is rated at 35 horsepower, and this is how the engines are lined up after testing in the production line before being dispatched to our valuable customers all over India. Now I come to the single cylinder engine, which is the next compact engine which was conceived about 6 years back in our company. It has 0.745 liter as the swept volume, and it is naturally aspirated. And it has got two ratings. One is at 17 horsepower at 2800 RPM, and this is mainly for tractors and industrial application. Constant speed at 10 horsepower, 1500 RPM. We have one more engine on the anvil which will be rated at 16 horsepower and 3000 RPM. We can make a 11 kVA engine, 11 kVA genset with this single cylinder engine. So this is the one which was designed from scratch by the group of young engineers and P.K. Sandil Kumar, and you can see the square top view. It is very difficult to usually achieve, and this is the cross section and side view, and this engine is tractorized. There are competing engines, single cylinder engines, they are of they are not truly tractorized. They are not able to take the bending and twisting load of the tractor. So this can take all that load. There are some small engines that are made of cast iron, okay. But the uniqueness of this is by the two attributes. One is it is completely balanced internally. That means all the primary forces are balanced and the engine is as quiet as a maybe a four cylinder engine, okay. And this is the internals of the single cylinder engine. The second important attribute is the governing. Normally a single cylinder engine is using a governor made by the engine manufacturer. For two cylinder and above, we use the fuel tank integrated with the governor produced by the fuel injection manufacturer. For example, Bosch. And Bosch has got makes thousands of pumps every day, and he has got computerized calibration bench, and he can precisely set it. Also, governor needs very high standard of accuracy of parts. In spite of that, if you see the droop, the speed droop of a mechanical governor for stable operation is about 10 to 15% at rated speed of 2200 and 2500. If you maintain 10 to 15% at rated speed of 2500, the droop will be very high at 1500 RPM. If you try to control the droop at 1500 RPM, it will become unstable at high speed. So there is a dilemma and there is a constant tug of war between the end user and the engine manufacturer in terms of tolerances and the required droop. The customer wants zero droop, that means the engine governing should be highly stiff. But by the theory of governors, unless there is a droop, which is nothing but a steady state error of a control system with a proportional control. Without a steady state error, the system is unstable. So it has to be greater than zero. But by considering friction and pulsating power production by the engine, you need a decent 10, 12, 15% for the governor to be stable at the rated speed. So to solve that, you have to provide an integrator. Providing an integrator in a mechanical governor is very expensive. Here what we have done, we have dismissed around 70 parts which are very small, like pins, rods, bushes, everything that are used in a mechanical governor. We have replaced it by only one link, okay, almost like a, this is a connecting rod, this is the crank, and this is the something like a piston, okay. So these are guided in a hole, and this governor has got an integrator. In electronics, you can introduce a integrator very easily. So this is having a zero droop, that means isochronous governing. So we give an engine to the customer which he wants, that means we have 0% droop, and this is ideal for agricultural tractors and off-road applications, and the customer feels the engine is having a lot of strength because there is no droop at all. And if I can brag a little about our engine, it is the only known single cylinder tractor engine that is controlled electronically in the world. And on the right side you see a speed part, which is nothing but a pedal. That means this tractor engine is driven by wire. So this is how the engine looks in production, okay. And this is the engine at test bed when we were doing optimization for performance and emission. On the left side you have the performance, and it passes emissions with flying colors. Okay, it passes there for final. And we have tractor application. You can see two tractors with two customers. And this tractor, according to our customer, works like the three-cylinder, tractor with a three-cylinder engine, which is already selling in large numbers for the past many years. So, in summary, we have a two-cylinder compact engine with swept volume 1.3 liters, primary forces balanced to 97% for high speed application. It is available in naturally aspirated form, rated at 16, 22, and 25 horsepower, also as a turbocharged intercooled engine at 23, 25.4, and 35 horsepower. In-phase movement of piston makes airflow pulses more uniform than conventional two-cylinder engine, and hence it is easily turbocharged. It is the first commercialized two-cylinder turbocharged intercooled engine in the world. Application is to tractors, gensets, marine, and other industrial applications. We have a single-cylinder engine of 0.745 liter designed and developed in India, in Chennai. Rated at 17 horsepower at 2800 for variable speed application and 10 horsepower at 1500. And it is the only known single cylinder tractor engine commercialized with electronic guard. Application is to tractors, gensets, and marine. Isochronous guarding is liked by tractor and genset customers. I want to thank you for patiently listening to this small talk.
Thank you, for all the young engineers here, this is a fantastic exposition of what you need to do to get a practical interview. Thank you very much, and there must be some questions. Any questions?
Any questions?
Can you highlight this up? I just want to know the process, this development process, what steps it contains.
Development, first we have to know the power. First we have to know the power, the speed, etc. There is a small, not a QFD, instead of saying big words, but we have a feeling. For example, why we went for 17 horsepower is, we have a 9 horsepower 3600 RPM as well as 23 horsepower 2500 RPM in the market. There is a gap, so we said we will introduce a 17 horsepower. Similarly, when we went for 20, why we didn't go for 26 or 27 horsepower? Because the emission standards are tighter. If you go above 25.4 horsepower, so we limit it to 25.4. Okay, and already the tractors are running at 19 horsepower, so we give extra power. So we do this internal discussion and take this idea. Then after that, we sit down and make all the design on paper with pencil. Okay, then do calculations, do many iterations. We don't have very advanced simulation or something like that. We do based on our experience, knowledge, and paper pencil method, calculations, all this. And in two or three trials, we get it right. And we have benchmarks. So we try to meet the benchmarks or beat them. Then we stop.
So the Indians, you showed that controlled by the mobile. Looking at the compact engine, to control by the mobile, you might put on various sensors.
Hello?
Various sensors, correct, to sense the quantities, which can sense.
Yeah, yeah. We have fuel level sensor.
Yeah.
We have lubricating oil pressure sensor.
Yeah, so that sensor.
All these are going to, all this data are going to small electronic equipment, which are displaying the data at the Jensen.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, we push a SIM card there.
My question is,
SIM card talks with our mobile, and our mobile has got activation to get the
data. Yeah, my question is that sensors will add an additional cost to the engines which may not be
required.
You
have to sell a genset with sensor. You have to sell the tractors with sensors. Okay.
There's one more question there.
Yes.
I have actually two questions. The first, what main targets you have kept? What main targets you have kept for these engines?
We made a single cylinder engine, that was 70 kg. But for tractor racing, we had to strengthen against torsion and bending, because this engine forms a part of the chassis, tractor chassis. So we are having around 110 kg. For example, this two-cylinder engine has got two weights. One is 160 kg with a cast iron crankcase. If you want to, you support the chassis. Tractor using the sump, but if you want to support the tractor using our crankcase, which is already rigid, we can use sheet metal sump that is 20 kg lighter. Okay, so we both are available. It's your choice how you want to design your vehicle.
Okay, and the another question is, how have you done the electronic governing for the tractor variable speed application?
For single cylinder?
Yes.
For single cylinder, we have the electronic governor.
Yeah,
it is
so
driven by wire. We have a pedal. This pedal is connected by wire to the electronic governor. The governor is in two parts. One is the actuator, and above the actuator is a small computer. And we program the computer before we flash the program and the data before sending it to the testing, and the password is not even known to me.
Okay. The question is like this: you said that it's a zero droop governor, right? And how it has been working for a tractor? This is the question.
Because there is an integral. If you have P, plain P governor, proportional governor, you can't work without a droop. You need a minimum droop. So thumb rule says 2500 RPM, you need around 15% droop. 10 to 15%. 10% if you are lucky, that you can do for a 6-cylinder or 4-cylinder engine. For 3-2-cylinder, you need at least 15%. But here there is an integral. Okay, integral means there is an integral of the errors for the which is having a convolution integral. That means it will not remember the errors that happened 2 hours back. It will remember the errors in the last few seconds. Okay. It will do a convolution integral and make corrections to the rack as per that. And by this, your Nyquist diagram is becoming bigger. Okay, you don't engross the pole. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
The next speaker is Dr. Dhananjay Kumar Srivastava. I was getting ready. I have a quick question for you.
Yes, sir.
Who supplies the turbocharger for the 2-cylinder?
This is Turbo Energy.
Which
is BorgWarner in India.
Oh, it's a BorgWarner?
BorgWarner is Turbo Energy in India. They make, this is the smallest turbocharger
this is what
so far in India. One company in Bangalore is attempting a smaller turbocharger.
Thank you very much. Okay. Dr. Srivastava is currently working in IIT Kanpur in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. He's an assistant professor. He obtained his PhD from IIT Kanpur as well in 2013. And he was a research fellow at University of Birmingham in UK in 2014. And also he spent some time in the University of Vienna in 2004. His areas of expertise in laser ignition, combustion visualization, emission control, and so on. And he has received the Gandhian Young Technological Innovation Award in March 2013 and the Poole Scientist Fellowship from the CSIR from 2010 to 2013. Dr. Srivastava.
Thank you, sir. First of all, very good evening to everyone and happy New Year. First of all, I would like to thank to the society for giving the opportunity for the presentation. And the topic of my presentation is the development of variable power control system for a spark ignition. Since we know that the government of India is pushing very hard for the electric vehicle, and according to the minister, by 2030, all the vehicles will be sold on the electric. So it's a great challenge for the existing conventional engine to compete and even perform really very well. So to improve the conventional engine, either there has to be modifications in the engine design or to optimize the conversion. There's two ways that by which we can further improve the performance of the conventional engine. So my talk is related with something with the design of the engine hardware systems so that we can improve the performance.
So the very basics of the IC engine, at first of all, the integration which takes place, followed by the compressor networks, and towards the
engine of this
compressor network, compressor networks,
then the spark takes place, and the following expansion takes place, and the final
So right from the beginning of the 4-stroke IC engine, box
and their design has played an important role in the gas system process. The gas system process in any IC engine have to deal with two fundamental functions. First is the induction of fresh air mixtures, as in case of port fuel injection system, or air, as in case of compression ignition system, or direct injection system in the intake stroke.
The second function of the gas exchange process
is the
ejection of
combustion products from the engine
cylinder in the exhaust
strokes. So, and the, in addition, the one of the important basic functions of the gas exchange process is to interlink between the intake and exhaust strokes to provide a mixed bag of operations which will either improve the performance of the engine or it will deteriorate. So that's why the ball events strongly detect the overall efficiency and the performance of the internal combustion engine. Let's have a look at what is the ball time requirement as a function of engine operating condition. So as far as the intake ball opening point is not to consider, is not only considered as the beginning of the intake stroke, but it also determines the duration of ball overlap during which the intake and exhaust valves open. If IVO occurs substantially before the TDC in the natural aspirated engine, then the exhaust products from the combustion chamber will flow in the intake manifold, and thus the exhaust will dilute the fresh air mixtures, and it will come back in the combustion chamber again when the pressure difference, when the pressure inside the combustion chamber falls below the pressure of the intake manifold by the virtue of piston motions. And this extensive backflow of the exhaust in the intake manifold takes place at the lower engine speeds. If IVO delays, then virtually we are insulating the combustion chamber through the intake manifold, it might affect the volumetric efficiency. So as far as the IVO concern in the engine, it is has a contradict requirement at the lower engine speeds or at the higher engine speeds and in between that. Similarly, if the intake valve closing is considered, the intake valve closing system normally takes place after the VDC to provide more time to fill inside the combustion chamber under the conditions when pressure inside the combustion chamber is still below than the intake manifold pressure when the piston reaches a VDC, particularly these conditions appears at the engine high speed. Thus, the higher speeds, the volumetric efficiency of the engine will be higher while penalizing it at the lower speeds. Because at the lower speeds, the engine pressure inside the combustion chamber and the intake manifolds are equal at the VDC itself. So therefore, it will push back the fresh air charge in the intake manifold. Again, in the IO also there is a conflict. Similarly, the exhaust opening point and the exhaust closing time has a contradict demand. So therefore, as of now, with the conventional valve intake systems, we have to trade off between the lower speeds and the higher speeds, and then we have to optimize the engine performance at the middle or somewhere where the engine has to operate for the longer durations. And therefore, we have a higher peak value in the narrow range of speed range. If the engine is operating on that range, then the power output will be reduced.
So,
conventional powertrain systems as now driven by the market mechanical technology to control the opening and closing of the exhaust and intake valve. IC engine has been long used the mechanical coupling in order to coordinate the valve timing with the crankshaft operations. And
then most of the IC engine as of now is used
the cam power mechanism to actuate the valve events, and the
depending upon the number of cylinders and number of valves, there are number of loops on the crankshaft that is called camshaft. And the camshaft and the crankshaft is connected through the chain mechanism with the gear ratio such that the rotation of the camshaft takes place only once with the two rotation of the crank. So what are the there is a possibility that with the optimization of the valve train systems, there is a possibility to increase the volumetric efficiency and hence the performance of the engine. With mechanical coupling in place, there is no need to worry about the synchronization of the valve events with the engine speed. But it is very important to understand that the synchronization of the valve event with the engine speeds is with the time is very important than with the angular positions. In other words, if the engine is running with higher speeds, then the opening and closing of the events has a very less time. However, in the angular positions and in terms of the angular positions, it remains the same. So, another is that cam lock has a continuous profile to check the dynamic force at the high speeds. So, the most of the cam profile is almost sinusoidal, and the amplitude of the sinusoidal curve determines the lift of the valve. Aggressive profile of the camshaft is very difficult. It's very difficult to make a steep difference and a steep profile change in the pad. Also, it is not possible to have an independent control of the valve timing or the lift. So therefore, we have to provide. So therefore, the fist and also the fist valve lift, in particularly in the gasoline engine, we have to provide some kind of the device to control the load of the engine, and at the simplest form is the throttle that incurs the pumping loss. Pumping loss is one of the important losses in the performance of the IC, either particularly the spark ignition engine, and particularly at the lower speeds, it varies from 20 to 25 to 30% of the loss. So, whenever the valve normally restricts the area of the airflow. If the engine is working at wide open throttle positions, then the restriction is very negligible. But if the engine is operating at the parked operations, then it restricts the area, and therefore the pressure difference is set up across the valve, and therefore the piston has to do the work in order to draw the air inside the combustion chamber. And that's why the loop at the bottom loop in the PV diagram represents the pumping loss. This pumping loss
is representative of the specific work lost. If it were possible to avoid this pumping loss, then the net specific work could have been possible to obtain even at the even with the expense of the lesser fuel consumption systems. So we still have two options as far as the work density system is concerned, that if we somehow have a flexible work timing systems, and if we can record, then we can improve the performance of the engine, and if somehow we can throw out or remove or get out from the throttle bars, then we can recover the pumping loss also. There are some variable valve actuation systems as of the current technology that is in the market, and several automotive manufacturers are using the VVA systems. One of them is the cam changing or the camshaft positions. Another is cam hazing situations, and third, that is the ultimate requirement, is the replacement of the camshaft itself, so it becomes the camless engine, and that will have a full flexibility of the control of the bar timing as well as the lift, as well as if you don't need to have a throttle bar. So this is the basic functions of the cam switching. The cam switching, it has a two sets of the cam, two sets of the cam on the same shaft. The two sets of the lobe, or that the two different ends have the same profile, and that has a smaller lift that is suitable for the low engine speeds. And the middle lobe has the high lift that is applied for the high engine speeds. And it is possible to latch and unlatch the systems so that we can have two sets of the valve. Two sets of the lift systems, one for the optimized for the lower engine speeds and another for the high speed applications. Other is the cam hazing. Cam hazing is the basic, one of the basic basic way to change the VVA, to obtain the VVA systems. It has a provision to rotate the cam shaft in the housing systems. It's with the high pressure loop valve, and in that way we can change the angular position, angular phasing between the crankshaft and the camshaft. But this system has only flexibility to change the, or it has flexibility to either advancing or retarding the valve time timing, but it doesn't have flexibility to change the lift systems. Then there's a commodity cam systems. This is a camless systems. The camless systems, because there is no camshaft, or thus the actuations of the valves can be controlled either by the electromagnetic or hydraulic or means. Now there is a lot of research is going on in all three different ways that how we can control it. As of now, I only find one of the company, the free valve company in the Sweden, they have a production grade of the VVA systems that is working on the electromagnetic systems. That's the video is here, by which they have achieved the camless engines. So the camless engine, now we have a camless engine, it has a full flexibility of changing the valve timing, lift, and also we don't need this possibility to not have a throttle valves in these systems. This kind of the system had advantages like increased idle stability or internal EGR, variable dynamic compression ratio, or cylinder deactivations. So with these systems, we are trying to develop pneumatic based VVA systems. Our first objective is to develop the systems and characterize the systems offline. Offline, it means we are not directly right now putting on the engine, we have removed the cylinder head and try to make the systems, develop the our control systems and run the valve without the camshaft. So there is a lot of solenoids. Each solenoid has a maximum capacity of 160 liters per minute, but we need a higher flow rate to increase the pressure in the actuation, double acting pneumatic situations. So therefore we have to use a number of solenoid valves that can be reduced to one if we have a very good quality of the solenoids, but this is the right now currently available in the local market or in here. So that's why we are trying to use first of all to set up the systems. So right now we are using four sets of four sets of the solenoid valves for the two valves. So this is the double acting pneumatic cylinders. So if there's cylinders, there's up from the, we can fill the cylinders from the upper end and from the bottom end also. So the S1 in from here, these two solenoids is using to pressurize the upper chamber of the actuator systems. S1 out, that is by which we can remove, we can discharge the air from the upper cylinders, and the similarly S2 in, that by which we can pressurize the bottom cylinders, and S2 out is the to discharge for the bottom cylinders. But one of the most critical parameters in the BBS systems is to control the seating velocity. Seating velocity is very important. If you cannot control the seating velocity with the valve is closing or sitting, then it will change the it will affect the material integrity and it will change the seating valve seating geometry. So that's why, and whatever the free valve system has developed, that is the hydraulic latch systems to control the damping of the piston movement, and that needs additional hydraulic circuits. What we are trying to do is to best only the pneumatic systems by which we can control the even damping systems, and we don't need the hydraulic latches kind of systems. So this is the way by which we are doing the systems. Simultaneously with these systems, we try to simulate the ball lift and the profiles, and the simulation curves is achieved like that. There is a slight damping at this point we have achieved, but that is it is okay. However, we are getting a nice kind of the profiles, and the opening and closing of the cylinder valves we are getting in the approximately 3.5 milliseconds, and the seating velocity profile is also coming under the max control. This is the systems that we have developed, and right now we have already characterized the valve profiles, and that is matching with our simulation systems. And now our next goal is to install the whole system from the engine, single cylinder engine, and to run the systems. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? By the way, I said you're from IIT Kanpur. I didn't tell you from Kharagpur.
So I did my PhD from IIT Kanpur. Right from IIT Kanpur. That's fine.
Yeah. Any questions? So how? What are you going to implement this in? What's the next step?
Now the next step, now we have done our control systems in such a way that we can achieve at the 800 RPM, at 1200 RPM, 1500 RPM and 1800 RPM. Mm-hmm. Our control system is like that. So we are going to implement this engine on the same engine, and the first objective is to, first of all, to maximize the volumetric efficiency.
What is the engine you are starting from?
It's a single cylinder spark ignition. Okay. And then once we have seen some even throttle system in with it, we just to try to see the whether it's possible to optimize the valve time at all these speeds to get the maximum volumetric efficiency, so that we can get some kind of the improvement in the efficiency or performance. And the next step, if it is going over there, then we try to remove this throttle permission, and since we have flexibility to control the lift systems, we directly control the airflow system through the valve lift, and we try to recover the pumping loss as is.
Any other question? If not, okay, thank you again.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we have now four short presentations, and I'd like to remind all the presenters that they will mark down if you go beyond their allotted time. They're going to be rated. So please keep in touch. So who's the first one now? I mean, let's see. The first presenter, is it Moitra Saxena?
They are not here.
No?
No.
They
move to the next
part. So, he's not there. Okay, well, we go to the next one, which is, is it Sarthak now? He is going to be talking about vibration analysis of hydrogen fumigated diesel engine.
Thank you, distinguished chair, respected audience. Good evening, everyone, and a very happy new year. My name is Sarthak Nag. I'm a master's student working at IIT Mandi under the guidance of Dr. Atul Dhar and Dr. Arpan Gupta. I'm here to present my work on vibration analysis of hydrogen fumigated diesel engines. The outline of my presentation will be, first I'll introduce you about why the need to do such work, then the experimental setup, the test metrics, the results, and in the end, the conclusion. Why hydrogen in CI engines? So we all have been hearing like there's been issues of fuel availability and pollutions and emissions norms are becoming stringent. So if you focus on emission reduction, so figure 1 shows the pollution map of Indian subcontinent on December 24, 2017. The one thing which worries me or all of us the most, a lot of purple spots are there near the capital of India, which is Delhi, and some near the Shanghai or the Beijing economic zone. So plus the vehicles in the world have already crossed 1.2 billion, and it is to be believed that over 900 million of these vehicles are working either on petrol and diesel. So if we introduce hydrogen in CI engines, there will be an ease of adaption in existing engines, as we need to replace only the valve, seals and some other components in the engine. But the problem with the hydrogen is having a very high self-ignition temperature. So to achieve this, either we need a very high compression ratio or we need a secondary fuel to rise the temperature for the ignition of the hydrogen. So what other better method than hydrogen ignition in the air intake? So hydrogen will be considered as a primary fuel, and diesel as a secondary fuel will be used to ignite the hydrogen. And now, what is the importance of vibration analysis? So vibration analysis is used for the diagnosis and control of combustion using accelerometer. Moreover, we can control the injection and we can do the condition monitoring while we are running the vehicle. And the fourth one is the sickness related issues. Some people face the issues of nausea. So there are different vibrations in the vehicle or in the engine. So that's the importance of vibration analysis. This is the experimental setup which we have developed in our lab. So starting from the left, we have a hydrogen line, and we have flame arresters and hydraulic seal, and then we inject the hydrogen in the air intake side. We also have a diesel line denoted by 11 and 12. The most important thing here is the position of the accelerometer, which is mounted on the head of the engine, and we are measuring the uprooting force or uprooting vibration in the engine. We are also using a pressure sensor, insulator pressure sensor, for the insulator pressure measurements. The test metrics and parameters. So we are operating the engine, the Kirloskar TV1 engine, at a constant speed of 1500 RPM, but we are varying load and hydrogen energy share. And the injection line of hydrogen has a pressure of 3 bar, and we are using a needle valve to control the flow rate of hydrogen. We start the injection of the hydrogen at 14.5 degree after TDC, and we stop it at 75.5 degree before bottom dead center. So we stop it well before the inlet valve closes, so that maximum, so that almost or more or less more amount of hydrogen is being inducted inside the engine. This is our test metrics for experiments. So first we'll see the pressure variation as a function of crank angle degrees at different loads. For the loads of 25 and 50%, we are seeing a drop in the cylinder pressure, which is mainly because of the dilution effect of hydrogen and decreased volumetric efficiency. The poor combustion efficiency of hydrogen at lower loads have also been reported by Zhu et al. In 2014. But at 75% load, due to the improved mean in cylinder temperature, we are seeing a higher or better combustion efficiency of hydrogen. If we go towards the vibration analysis, the figure 6 shows the events captured by the accelerometer. So our exhaust valve closes at around minus 356 degree, and then our inlet valve closes. Combustion occurs near at 0 degree crank angle, and exhaust valve opens at 144, and then again the inlet valve opens at 356. The figure 7 shows the RMS values of accelerations. So for the load of 25 and 50%,
we are seeing a drop, a gradual drop in the acceleration, which is due to drop in cylinder pressure. But at 75% load, we are seeing the increase, which can be inferred from the cylinder pressure plots, which we have seen as the combustion efficiency is improving. These graphs shows the vibration and the combustion data on the same scales. Now we have also measured the combustion noise. Combustion noise has been calculated using the data from the in-cylinder pressure sensor, and the trends are quite in agreement with the what we are seeing from the data from the accelerometer. So for the 50% and 25% loads, we are seeing a drop in the combustion noise, but for the 75% load, we are seeing a gradual increase in the combustion noise, where it goes from 88.57 dBA to 90 dBA. And the last plot which we have here is the short time Fourier transform analysis of vibration analysis. So if you focus on the load of 75%, so what we are seeing as the hydrogen energy share is increasing, we are seeing quite a better concentration of frequencies above 10,000 Hz. So the complete combustion of hydrogen causes the vibrations of higher frequencies. The main takeaways from this work are the in-cylinder pressure decreases for the load of 25 and 50%, but more prominent combustion was observed from 75%. The trends shown by the combustion noise were in agreement with the vibration signal. And the major takeaway is the analysis of accelerometer data points toward a possible cost-effective solution for the engine combustion control without using costly and intrusive in-cylinder pressure diagnostic sensors. Thank you.
Yes,
we are planning to implement this on our engine in the lab.
Okay, last chance for questions. No, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So, who's then Gaurav Tripathi?
Research scholar in IIT Mandi under the guidance of Dr. Atul Dhar. This is my oral presentation topic, numerical investigation of effect of methane addition on combustion and emission characteristics of CI engine in dim fuel mode. This is the outline of my presentation, introduction, dual fuel mode conversion, simulation sector case, result, and on the basis of that, conclusion. Introduction. Why there is need to use some alternative fuel in IC engine? Because their conventional energy sources are limited, and if we import oil from other country, then it put adverse effect on economics and greenhouse gas effect from engine put result in global warming and melting of polar ice caps, and also government body put restriction over emission norms, emissions of engine. So there is need to use some alternative fuel such as methane and other in IC engine. Dual fuel mode conversion. Here diesel is injected directly into the cylinder, while other fuel, methane, is injected into the intake manifold with air on constant energy supplementation mechanism. Use of methane has some advantages such as modification in engine require minimum, and it has lean burning capability, and transportation of methane is easy. Some other researchers also work on that, and reported that it has reduced HCN-CO emission and Carbo et al. Also investigated the effect of methane addition with diesel result in increased BSFC and decreased direct thermal efficiency. Simulation of sector case. Here I simulate a 45 degree sector case of engine cylinder with the help of Converse software, and you vary the methane energy share 10%, 25% and 50% on constant energy substitution method, and see their effect on combustion and emission characteristics. This slide shows the validation of my simulation case. First figure shows the grid independency. Grid independency, in which as we refine the grid size, the result improves but computational time increases. So I choose 2.3 as the optimum grid size. And second figure shows the pressure trace of simulation curve with validation with experimental data, and we got good agreement between them. This is the result. As we add methane, see the result that shows addition of methane on effect on injection velocity. As we add methane, injection velocity decreases because less amount of diesel injected for same duration. That put adverse effect over combustion and pressure and heat release rate trace. This slide shows the addition. This slide shows the effect of methane addition over the pressure trace and heat release rate trace. As we add methane, pressure decreases as well as heat release rate decreases because of slow burning rate of methane and higher specific heat capacity of methane. This curve shows the effect of methane addition over the hydrocarbon emission and carbon monoxide emission. With addition of methane, hydrocarbon emission goes on increasing because methane burns slowly, so some part of methane remains unburned and emit as hydrocarbon emission. Carbon monoxide emission, with small addition of methane, carbon monoxide emission decreases because of better diffusivity of methane, but more addition of methane result in increase in CO emission because of replacement of oxygen. This is the curve shows the effect of methane addition over the NOx and soot emission. As we with small addition of methane, combustion efficiency improves, so combustion temperature increases, so there is increase in NOx emission, and soot emission decreases. While when we add more methane, oxygen content is replaced by methane, so combustion temperature decreases and NOx decreases while soot increases. Based on this simulation result, we can conclude addition of methane result in decreasing peak pressure heat release rate while HC emission increases. NOx emission increases up to 25%, after that NOx emission decreases. 25% methane energy substitution is considered as the optimum for the reduced soot and CO emission. Thank you.
Any questions?
Why there is so little difference between experimental result and simulation result?
Because of use of different mechanism. If we use some other mechanism in Converge, we can get.
So in Converge, which mechanism is being used?
In Converge, mechanism is used, but I use say solver for that is a full chemistry, detailed chemistry solver for the combustion modeling. If we use different mechanism, we get good result.
So I'm a bit confused here. I mean, you know, is there a flame in the cylinder? You said methane burns slowly.
Methane has higher specific capacity, so it absorbs more heat to burn.
No, but is it auto ignition or is it flame development? I mean, what is happening in the methane? What does your combustion model say? Are you using a chemical kinetic model to see auto ignition? When you say a mechanism,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Is it a chemical
chemistry solver?
I I don't understand what exactly is happening in your model in the cylinder or in the engine. I mean, you know, quite often when you put methane in the cylinder, you use the diesel as a sparkler, basically. Ignite and set off a flame, right? Or you can also have auto ignition, or, you know, compression ignition. So I'm not sure what is
we added within with air and in CI engine, in diesel engine.
Okay.
Some part of the diesel replaced with energy replaced with methane. Yes.
Okay, any other question?
So have you actually injected the methane or it is inducted to the intake air?
Sir, I mix methane with air in intake manifold.
Okay.
So if all energy supplied by diesel, some part of diesel energy is replaced with methane energy.
And then how will you control the flow rate in order to control the 25%, 50%, 75% of the total loss?
Sir, by replacing air. If fraction of air is 1, then
percentage you mentioned 75%, 50%. 10%. Replacement with the air or with the equivalent diesel?
Sir, replaces air.
Volume, by volume.
By volume. Okay.
That's quite a lot. 50% volume air would be. Okay, anyway. We need to. Okay. Who's the next one? Yep, please. This is Chetan Kumar, right?
Yes.
On the topic is let us pay and combustion investigation in a heavy duty optical diesel engine filled with waste cooking oil, jet fuel, and garage of air diesel. This work is conducted in the association with IIT Kanpur. This is a joint collaboration project for IIT Kanpur and Korea Advanced Institute of Science and Technology. So, overview of my presentation, I am showing introduction, spray and combustion visualization, and after that, short conclusion. So, why biodiesel? Biodiesel is showing some acceptance in some automotive companies. Biodiesel has oxygenated, it is oxygenated fuel, but it has a higher density, higher viscosity, and lower calorific value. So, these are the issues. And because of that, emissions, NOx emissions are higher, cold start problem, and some corrosion issues are there. This is the classification of biodiesel. In first generation, there is edible biodiesel. Second generation is inedible biodiesel, and third generation is algae-based biodiesel. So my work is basically mainly focused on second generation biodiesel. My research objectives is spray and combustion visualization of biofuels in optical engine, spray tip penetration and spray conical measurement at 40, 60 and 120 MPa. Pressure, flame luminosity also measured at same injection pressure. So what are the test fuel properties and injector specification? this is a 7-hole injector and it has a hole diameter of 130 micron and spray angle is 150 degree. Another thing is that density of waste cooking oil, karanja, jethro biodiesel is higher as compared to diesel. Similarly, kinematic viscosity is also higher. Another important property is oxygen content in diesel and biodiesel. So, biodiesel have approximately 10% of oxygen content inside. So this is the experimental setup at Korea Advanced Institute of Science and Technology, where this is the this is the optical window, and this is the hollow inverted piston, and here there is one mirror is provided, and whatever combustion any phenomena happen here, that is captured by a high speed camera. And injection quantity is 30 milligram per stroke, injection pressure is 40 atm 120 megapascal, injection timing is 5 mmHg before top dead center, and engine speed is constant 1200. So this is a actual experimental setup at Korea Advanced Institute of Science and Technology. I'm sorry that this video is not working, so I move to some spray ventilation images. So this is for diesel, and this is for biodiesel, and so I calculate spray tip penetration and spray cone angle for 40, 80 and 120 megapascal. I found that for all the test fuels at actual engine condition, there is no significant difference I observed in spray tip penetration for one specific fuel injection pressure. But with increasing in injection pressure, spray development is faster. And spray cone angle, I found that the biodiesel fuel showed wider spray cone angle. This is also video is not working, so I move to in cylinder combustion visualization, and this is at 40 megapascal fuel injection pressure. And I found that this is for images for diesel, the Jethro biodiesel, Brenzer biodiesel, and West cooking oil biodiesel. And I found that Jethro biodiesel and Brenzer biodiesel showed the earlier flame luminosity as compared to diesel and West cooking oil biodiesel. So I calculate flame luminosity for 40, 80, and 120 megapascal. I normalize flame luminosity and put it on 0 to 1 scale. And I found that at 40 megapascal injection pressure, all the biofuels shows higher flame luminosity compared to diesel. But with increasing in injection pressure, you can see at 80 MPa and 120 MPa, waste cooking oil biodiesel shows slightly lower flame luminosity as compared to diesel and biodiesel. Why this and at higher more higher injection pressure it is lower. So it suggests that biodiesel waste cooking oil biodiesel fuel shows less soot and better combustion at higher fuel injection pressure. Why this phenomena happen? Because at higher injection pressure, waste cooking oil they have a comparatively lower viscosity as compared to current gen Jethrofa biodiesel, and because it has a lesser viscosity, so here oxygen content plays important role. And if viscosity is higher, then oxygen content for biodiesel is not playing a dominant role. So that is so clear, because you know oxygen content for all the biodiesels are similar. But this is not occur at the lower injection pressure. But at higher injection pressure and with lower viscosity for waste cooking oil biodiesel, they have a lower Southern wing diameter. And this lower Southern wing diameter and better atomization has been resulted into lower soot, lower luminosity for and lower soot for waste cooking oil biodiesel. So my conclusion is that increase in FIP resulted in decrease in injection timing. Similar penetration observed for all test fuels
why diesel should, why does spray conical compared to diesel and should luminosity observed higher for biodiesel compared to diesel except for waste cooking oil barrel? Thank you.
Thank you. Any question?
What modification you have done in the engine?
No, this is this work is conducted at Korea Advanced Institute of Science and Technology.
Okay.
And I will show you the modification. What the modification did? We also have a optical engine, but okay. So this is a six-cylinder engine, and they utilized one cylinder. Okay. And another important change is that they elongated the piston, and this piston is hollow inside. Okay. And optical crown piston crown is optical. So whatever process happen here, that is reflected in mirror, and from that we captured from, by this camera. So another thing is that here two type of optical engines are available. Here this piston crown is optical, and in our lab we have a cylinder wall is of it is optical, so we cannot measure in our lab.
Is there any
difference in chemical properties between first and second generation biodiesel?
I don't know exact answer for that, because we didn't measure the detailed chemical property. Which kind of property you mean to say?
That comes into picture in combustion.
No. So important property is viscosity, density, and other than that, which kind of property?
Does it vary from first generation to second generation?
Because first generation is edible, and you know that there is always a debate of food versus fuel. What is important? And generally in India, we are not getting food. So okay, so that's why first generation we are moved to second generation biodiesel, and from why second generation to third generation is that algae based fuel is developed in small place and larger scale. So that's why this kind of so this is not based on I think the chemical property. This is based on the availability and various this kind of issues.
Then result will remain the same whether you go for first generation or second generation.
Absolutely, result will be same, but we can improve the chemical. We can improve the process, making process, and after that we can try to reduce the viscosity. As I showed you that viscosity plays a dominant role. Okay, if viscosity is improved, then it can be replaceable. I mean, this is a 100% biodiesel. Generally, in, we tested in 100% biodiesel, but generally in auto transportation engine, in our lab, 20% biodiesel is successfully tested. With some, it has some durability issues, but yeah.
This is the last presentation. I'll take some more questions.
Dr. Chetan,
yes.
This is only one comment I would like from you. That when you are varying the injection pressure from 40 MPa to 120 MPa,
yeah.
Three times,
yeah.
But still, if you see the penetration length,
captured in actual engine. Okay, so it reaches to the maximum length,
so
and after that it is
constant of the engine.
It is a constant of the engine. Yes.
Right. Do you have a question?
No, I just wanted to add his point that he was asking this. So it used to vary a lot because even if you go for the feedstock from where, let's say, this particular current itself, even if you are going for different feedstock, it used to change. And even for different variables, it used to vary a lot. So it depends on the saturation and unsaturation factors. There's a lot of factors in that.
Okay. Let's call this a day for this. And we have to present this, right?
We have types of mobile phones for our keynote speakers and other speakers.
Okay.
Thank you.